here we are going to install the DC protection circuit, which you will notice is vastly different from the one used in the phase linear 400. So anyway, that being aside, you know, of course, comparing the model 700 to the 400, you know, the 700 is an amp and a half. Actually, I should say an amp and three quarters. Okay, in your hardware package, you will have a set of aluminum standoffs. Yours will be bare metal unless you have done what I have done and put shrink wrap tubing on them. I just do that because I love that crazy stuff. Screw these onto your binding posts here. And since there is no hex shape to these, you're only going to have your fingers to tighten them on. There also are screws on here that maybe you should have removed before you put this thing on there. You know, remove the screws from those. Okay, I'll actually do this the right way on the next one. Hey, another thing about this shrinky tube is that it gives you a little more grip, you know, more of an anti-slip grip on those. Maybe I should have said before I started that you ought to make sure that your binding posts are secure on there, that they are mounted very solidly and securely. Otherwise, they will twist around while you try to snug these babies down. So do that before you jump right into it. But since I'm making a video, I'm just going to jump right into it. Actually, I did that because I realized they were loose, and every video I've made so far seems to have some kind of snafu to it. Okay, install all of your standoffs on here, and the relay circuit then goes on top like that, and then you may use a screwdriver. In fact, I hope you use a screwdriver to do this. This makes the contact to your speaker binding posts here. The electricity goes through those standoff poles. Okay, physically mounting this thing is pretty easy. Then you have to make the electrical connections, the electronic connections, which is this little bundle of things right here that we've neglected for a while. The yellow wires from your backplane boards. And yeah, that's it. Hey, well, how about that? I did get a snafu after all. Good old hemostats. Yeah. Come here, baby. Yeah. They've become magnetized. And tighten those down. Did I warn you about those binding posts, by the way? I'm so redundant with everything else. Be careful how hard you tighten those nuts on there, because these bodies are plastic. The bodies of these things are plastic. If you over-tighten them, you will break them. I have these nice package of multicolored ones because being a Mr. Phonograph guy, I wanted to do the same color scheme as the wires that connect your phonograph cartridge. But I found out that these are metric thread and they won't work. Okay, they are marked on here. AC, ground, right, ground, and left. Okay, so we have the right channel. No, this is the left channel. I'm looking at it upside down. Left channel, going to hook up to that connect there. Right channel up to that connect there. And these gray wires that we've been neglecting for a month and a half, these are going to go into ground, ground. And the AC, two black AC wires, and the white ground from your neutral bus between the capacitors is going to connect to there. So let's make a judgment on how long everything has to be. We can start trimming things down. When you strip your wires, tin them with some solder. What that will do is prevent any stray wires, any stray strands from going into the wrong portal on this connector. So, okay, I will turn the camera off and do this behind your front. You will not see the magic that I am going to perform because it takes too much time and I make these videos too dang long. All right, now here we see all the wiring connected up. Is the left channel output from the back plane board, the two gray wires from the neutral bus between the capacitors, the right channel output, the two black wires that come from your rectifier legs, remember way back when we did that, this white ground wire here also is connected to that neutral bus. So, okay, you have power. First three are power. The next four are signal. Now we can do one of two things here. We can assume that this is ready to fly and start working on other parts, or we can test it, and I think it's a good idea to test it. The instructions do recommend a dim bulb startup, and I keep moving that heat sink on that transistor. I'd like to have some air between those, if you don't mind, please. And I give up on this capacitor right here. It's just going to have to lay flat. Okay, yes, they do recommend a dim bulb startup. And also some frequency tests that determine that this is operating correctly. Now, this is supposed to prevent presentation of direct current to your speakers, which is a damaging force, especially when you're talking about the full load of these power capacitors dumping directly into your speakers. It's going to blow them up. This prevents that. It prevented that when I had a transistor failure on my 400. So the circuit is a worthwhile circuit to put in. You should consider it very strongly. A lot of people think this is optional. I beg to differ on that. I don't think so. This is a very necessary and vital part of your amplifier. Okay, let me figure out how I'm going to do some frequency tests. I'll do a dim bulb startup because they tell me to do so, and then we'll get on with this. You ready for this? Okay. Make sure for this time that you have the power plugged into the back of the amp, unlike the last time. Okay, have your DVT ready, your dim bulb test, and put it in two. Okay, the amplifier plugged into that, and that plugged into power strip, and that is on. Ready for flying hot glass shards, and here we go. And the light dims. Oh, and I just heard the relays click. I don't know if you heard that either. Okay, they went bing bing. Okay, we're satisfied with that. Yes, they click. Let's try a full power startup. Ready for this? Yes, they click. All right. Consider your amplifier actually done at this point, except for the front and hooking up the inputs and all that. So actually, yes, we have so far success. No major snafus other than dropping a screw and making sure that I corrected a snafu before I started this video. All right. Next step is to do some frequency sweeps and to determine when this baby cuts out. I'm going to disconnect the power to make sure no accidental things happen while I'm not watching. That seems to be the case in a lot of things. Alrighty. Okay, go on to some screen captures on the computer. All right, wow, this is crazy. I had to blow up my screen to make sure I've got everything included in here. Anyway, we are going to go to an application called Audacity. And we are going to create a new file here. This application also works with generic computers as well. So, tracks, we got to add a new track, just make a monaural track. Okay, now, what we're going to do here, according to the instructions, if a signal generator is available, insert a 1 kilohertz sine wave into the left channel. Set the generator level to obtain 40 volt AC on the amplifier output. Good grief, that's like 200 watts. Okay, let's zoom back a little bit. I am assuming that this is minutes. Select about 5 minutes. Okay, and what we want to do is generate a tone, generate a sine wave of 1 kilohertz, which is 1000 hertz, amplitude 0 to 1. Well, that will give you a 0 dB. So 5 minutes. Okay, there we go. Good. All right, tell it okay. All right, let's play this and listen to a 1 kilohertz. That's pretty dang annoying. Okay. Do we get to name it? Yeah. All right, we're going to name this 1KHZ, 1 kilohertz. Don't go boomp at me. Okay. All right, now let's make another track. It doesn't have to be stereo. Okay, the instructions say also now, decrease the frequency until the relay clicks. Well, that's going to be a difficult thing to do. This should be between 1.1 hertz and 30 hertz. Tell you what we're going to do. Let's guesstimate that.
let's generate a tone in the middle of 15 hertz. Why are you booping at me? All right, look at that. Notice the difference. We can mute this track and let's play a 15 hertz track. Ha ha. I don't hear something. Oh, that's 5 seconds, not 5 minutes. Okay. Well, 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 well. Okay, well, you see what I'm doing. I'm going to redo this file. Okay, let's add a new track. Raise the frequency to above 100 hertz. So on this, we're going to generate another tone above 100 hertz. Let's make this 150. That's above. Okay. Alrighty. Now, let's mute the 15 hertz and play what 150 hertz sounds like. And that's just as annoying. So, okay. I'm going to, this is for the sake of demonstration right now. Let's unmute all of them. Let's hear what they all sound like in concert. That's pretty awful. Anyway, that's what you want to do to do a frequency test. Anyway, they recommend these three frequencies. These things are not variable, unfortunately, on Audacity, so I don't have a frequency sweep generator. So anyway, we're going to save project, and for Audacity, not an audio file, blah, 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 use export, don't show this warning again. Well, okay, all right, save it, and it's going to tell me untitled op. Okay, test, and let's save it to the desktop, and let's go. Okay, there you go. Now, Audacity, let's exit. Now, when you want to move this to a flash drive, remember, you have to move this data file, this data folder, as well as the Audacity file. So save both of those to a flash drive to put it on your laptop and connect your laptop to the inputs of the your control board and do your frequency test sweep. All right, let's get on with that next. All right,
now to test your circuit. Helps if things are plugged in. To test your circuits, of course, you're going to need your signal source. You're going to need this. You're going to need a DVM. Prepare yourself. You're going to have to get an audio cable, one that you can sacrifice. Okay, so you're going to have to cut off one set of plugs at one end, strip and tin the wires, because right now I don't have the back panel jacks connected, so I got a light in the way, don't I? You will need to power up everything. I have a little baby Fisher-Price oscilloscope here, and let's start this thing up too. What you will need to do is inject your signal into your amplifier and adjust the volume so that you get 40 volts alternating current into the voltage meter. So let us, and one thing I need to show you, these binding posts have a very convenient little hole in them that your test probe will fit into, and you can clamp it down quite nicely to measure your output voltage. All right, with all that in mind, everything is powering up quite nicely. I need to log into. All right, one curious thing that I need to satisfy in my own mind is, first off, what is the voltage output of this MacBook here? Okay, and let us mute all the high frequency, low frequency stuff. Okay, and play. Okay, we see a waveform here. This is just to check to make sure that I've got some kind of signal coming out. And I have 0.848 volts. So 0.8, I've got about a half a volt. I mean, almost a volt output. And we don't want to start this thing blasting off. Where's the volume control here? Let's bring that volume down. That's supposed to work through the keyboard, but it doesn't. So let's bring that to a very minimum, and I hear noise outside. So you can see as I raise the volume on that little Fisher-Price oscilloscope there, the amplitude of the wave changes. And also does the voltage on there. Okay, so now let's stop that from playing and connect the inside. Connect. Okay. I have on here the white, which is the left channel, feeding directly into that. And I need to hook up the output voltage. So let's turn the amplifier on. And we hear the nice click of the relays in there. Touch nothing because this is a live circuit now. And we play. Where's my other little camera? I'm going to have three cameras going here. What was that process back in the 60s? Cinerama. They used three cameras and three projectors to make a widescreen video. Okay. Now this is connected to the outputs. And we need to go into the 200 volt AC range because it's higher than 20. And hit play. Okay, let's go to the volume control. Hello, there it is. And inch that up. 5 volts. 10, 11. Supposed to get this up to 40 volts AC. I don't know if I'm going to be able to achieve that. I've got 30 volts. Well, You know, the last time I checked this out, I did this test, was on a phase linear 400, and it cut out at 17 hertz. We got the other camera going here. Turn it on. And let's mute the 1 kilohertz. And go down to the 15 hertz. We should hear a relay click. And we don't. Ha ha. So, maybe 15 is not low enough. Or maybe because I do not have sufficient output, 30 volts. Let's go to 150. Yeah, I'm still only reading like 30, 31, 30.7. I guess that equals 31. Go back down to the 15 hertz. Oh, I've got multiple channels playing here. Still getting output. So maybe if I change the playback speed, there it went. I heard it. I heard it. It cut out. So I change. Don't do that, stupid computer. Let me bring that playback speed back up, and it just clicked back on again. So I have no idea what hertz I'm running, because I do not have a variable pitch output on this baby. So unfortunately, that's a drawback to testing it like this. Okay, well, I'm convinced, I'm satisfied that this passed the test of this. So I'm going to switch off and now change that input into the right channel and do the same test over again. Let me stop this. In your documentation, it tells you which of these pads connect to which part of the amplifier. Pad number 1, 1R and 1L, one right, one left. Pad number 1 is audio signal in. Pad number 2 is audio ground. Okay, now we're ready to fly again. All right. Okay, start your engines. And we have a click of the relays. And hit the play button on my audio file. And again, I got 30.3 volts on the DVM. Okay. I'm going to mute that. Let's unmute the 15 hertz signal. And it's still running. Let's bring this down. Playback speed 0.53 of 15 hertz. There you go, 0.26, and it cuts out. 0.53 cuts back in. 0.13. Let's go back to 1.0, and it cuts back in. Okay, so 1.3 times 15 hertz. That's a pretty low frequency. So, and I have to say though, putting test tones through an amplifier is quite different from actually playing playing a tape or an album, because an audio file is actually quite complex. So, for example, I just happen to have a file here, a record that I have that I didn't have in digital version. I don't know why that thing is there. Okay, let me go to full view. Hello? All right. And hit the play on here. Where's my volume? You know, I hate this feature. I'm glad they got rid of it. Here we go. And here you see how complex an audio file is. There, if we zoom up. Now this line in the center represents neutral, and the waveform represents signal. So if you look at that and take into consideration that this is a very complicated alternating current waveform. And when you put them through a speaker, you get that. Well, come on now. Starts at the beginning again. Okay, not what I want. I hope YouTube doesn't bust me for this, because I'm playing copyrighted music. So, anyway, that's how the test went on this. So, knowing that, we can disconnect my little temporary connections here and be satisfied that I know that if I have an extreme record warp, which, by the way, a subsonic filter should cut all of that out, I would hope, I would expect. Anyway, I predict no horrible problems. Again, the thing is designed, if you have a transistor fused and it dumps the entire contents of your power capacitors into your speakers, this thing will save you your speakers, and you do the dimbulk check out, test your transistors and find out what's faulty. This thing will save a lot of money and heartache and pee-offedness. So anyway, that's it passes my satisfaction, so I'm pretty ready to go on to stringing up the power meters in the front face of this baby. All right then, until next time, I will produce another video for you at a future unnamed and undisclosed date. Alrighty. Mazel tov. Mazel tov to the other camera, too.